everybody. This is Christopher with IG Productions. Welcome back to another episode of Hidden Treasures. Let's roll a D6 die and see where we're going to be searching for some hidden treasures today. Looks like we rolled a 3. That means that we now get to head to the Closet of Mystery and see what kind of hidden treasures we can dig up. So I'm here at the Closet of Mystery. Let's step inside and see if we can find a really cool hidden treasure.
Check this out.
Rogal Dorn, by any other name, is still Rogal Dorn. Let's have a look at him on the table. So let's have a look at Rogal Dorn by the name of the Castellian Knight. This model is very, very obviously Rogal Dorn, but it's manufactured by a company other than Games Workshop, so they can't call him Rogal Dorn. This particular company is called Kabuki Models. I believe, if I remember correctly, they are an Italian-based company. And what they do is they make a lot of different miniatures, but one of their lines is sort of alternate sculpts for many of the Primarchs from the 40K universe. This happens to be one of them. Most of these Primarchs are a limited edition print. So, for instance, they may make 500 of a particular piece, and then they're not going to make any more after that. In fact, when I purchased this one several years ago, they had already gone through several of the other Primarchs, and those Primarchs were no longer available at the time. So, they are kind of hit and miss. You may have already missed a bunch of them, like I did, and you may be able to find a few of them still in limited edition form that you can pick up. Now, most of the time, if you look for Kabuki models on eBay or something along the lines of maybe Kabuki Primark or something like that, you can generally find a lot of the out-of-print editions without any difficulty whatsoever. But let's take a look at this, what we're calling the Castellian Knight here, and see exactly what we've got. You can see very simple packaging, just a simple blister pack. I've already cut the top of it here to make it easy to open. That's really the only thing holding it together is this simple, this simple label, really, wrapped around the inside. There's no staples or anything on the edges like you may see with some other miniature manufacturers. So it's very easy to get into. Let's take a look and see what we have. Alright, so we have a base here. Very, very, very nicely done. I tell you what, let me just pull every piece out and then we'll look at the thing as a whole. How about that? Let me set that table behind me. And we'll zoom in just a bit here. So let's start with the base. Right about there. That's actually a lot further away from myself than I figured it would be. Very nicely done, cast in resin. Looks like it's a drop cast piece just based on the fact that we have air bubbles on the bottom, so it's probably sculpted so that they can pour the resin in like this and the bubbles just rise to the surface this way. I don't see any major undercuts that would make that a problem. Pretty nicely done. The feathers on the eagle are... they don't have a lot of detail to them. Most of them have just a single little cut in the middle to kind of indicate the hint of some texture, but nothing major. I'm kind of confused by this wing over here. I guess maybe it's supposed to be like a ruined statue or something like that, and you've got part of the wing on this side over here broken off or something. I don't know. But pretty neat. You've got some decent texture on the floor there. You could either, you know, call that cracked floor, or you could call it maybe some granite or something like that, maybe even some marble. Pretty decent looking base. Not very flat on the bottom. There is a lot of texture that would have to be ground down, but a simple, 15, 20 seconds just going back and forth across a piece of sandpaper like that would probably get most of those raised areas off. And that is a problem that is typical with drop casting. You end up with like a little meniscus that kind of curves up on the edges of anything that you drop cast. The center will typically be much lower than the edges will. The edges kind of curl like this. And it's really easy to get rid of those, so not a big drawback. All right, so main body of the miniature, right here. He's missing his leg, although he looks like he's in the middle of a front kick, but he's really not because I believe that his leg is bent. Got this really nice eagle design. Again, not a lot of incredible detail in the wings of the eagle, just very, very, very simplistic. Got this really cool face right here on the belt buckle. I like that a lot. Just some various filigree with some lightning bolts coming down from that belt buckle area. Very, very simplistic design, but very almost an elegance and a formality to it. I like the little decorum or the brocade work here on the shoulder pauldron. I don't know if you guys can see that. Let me zoom in a little bit further and then get rid of some of the light so maybe you can see it. It's hard to see, but it looks like just some basic maybe laurels, if I had to guess. Just some leaf work. So very, very simplistic. You've got this basic, and I mean very basic, backpack right here with these little jets coming out the bottom of it. So very simple backpack, and just a pretty cool little model here. So you've also got a keyed section here and a keyed section here, so that's kind of nice. It's not keyed to the point where you're limited as to exactly how you can put the miniature together, but it is keyed enough to where you're not going to get the connecting piece off-centered, which is nice. You don't have to worry about putting in your own pin. Although, in looking at the fit up here, it's going to fit up in kind of the Superman pose. There is a little bit too much of a key there, so you would actually have to grind that down. You can see that once I put these two pieces together here, there's a bit of a gap between them. You can kind of see my finger as it appears and disappears behind there. So, not too bad. As far as mold lines go, I don't see a lot. There's a little teeny, a hint of a mold line there. You can actually see it now as I've got the light shining on it. Just running kind of up the side of the leg right there. Very, very simplistic cleanup with a file. Probably no more than, maybe 15, 20 minutes for the entire miniature. And that's if you're being very, very meticulous. Looking at the fist here, we have, this is nice, we have that lightning bolt pattern that we had on the tabard here, right there. We have that continued into the fist area, which is very, very cool. That gives us a nice continuity between parts of the model. And then if we take the left leg here, we also have that lightning bolt pattern continuing in the left leg of the miniature. Plus, we have that face pattern of the belt buckle continuing in the left leg of the miniature. And as I said, he's kind of jumping in this particular pose. So I assume that he would fit something like yay on his base. All right, so that's not too bad. Okay. All right, let's see what else we have here. We have this piece here, and I'm going to have to get the image from the thing here. Oh, this is his left shoulder pauldron with this giant eagle on it. Okay, so there we go. That's pretty cool. Big old fat eagle. Let me get that out of the way. All right. You have a cape here, although I don't know. I suppose probably maybe connects here. Interesting. Let's see here. The flow would flow like, has to be that way. Is there a connecting point on this shoulder pauldron? There is, but I don't think that's meant to be how it's connected, or how it connects. I'm not quite sure where the cape goes, and there's no indication on the picture as to what the back of the model is supposed to look like. You can see the cape flowing back here, so I assume that with this detail work here, that this is the outside of the cape, and so that, like, this will be the model over here, but I don't know where specifically this connects, because there is no actual connecting spot that I see on this miniature for a cape. That kind of, it's sort of interesting. Maybe it connects like down here. I don't know. There's no real, I guess that could work. I mean, it's about the right height, so maybe it's something a little bit lower than the backpack. I don't know. That's a little annoying, I will admit. So we have our first drawback. We have pieces that we're not exactly sure where they go. Okay, and then we have, let's see, what do we have here? We have the left arm. Again, continuing that lightning bolt pattern on the left arm, as well as we have yet another face on the elbow of the left arm there. So that's pretty cool. And then we have this really, really interesting blade right here that's not even, you can't even really see it in the picture. You can just see the hilt of it right here. But I like the cross piece on this blade. Look at that. It's sort of an off-centered wing setup. That's very, very cool. So that actually really, it ties in quite well with this this piece on the bottom here that has the busted up wing. So maybe this wing over here is not really broken. Maybe that's the way it's supposed to look. Maybe that's the way it was. Well, I mean, it does have kind of a broken looking edge to it. Maybe just thinking in terms of Warhammer lore, I don't recall one of the eagle's wings being shorter than the other, but the continued pattern here is very, very nice because it kind of gives a continuity across the miniature. Very, very cool. I like that feature. That's quite nice. You have this piece here, which is a giant freaking eagle, which simply sits and rests on the back of the miniature right there. It's a nice little piece. And the connecting point is basically the flat of this backpack right here. So the only concern I would have here would be getting this thing to stay on. There's no way you would be able to drill through this enough to get a pin in here. So that piece is probably going to fall off if I had to take a wild stab. You could probably glue it up with some 5-minute epoxy and get a decent bond. But I foresee that piece coming off if this model was ever dropped or, you know, tips over on the battlefield. We've already gone over the shoulder pauldrons. The only thing left is the head. And I got to tell you, the head is the only thing that doesn't seem to fit. And I don't mean that like in the physical sense of it doesn't fit into the spot here. It fits fine. But the head is tiny. I mean, like, really, really, really freaking small in comparison to the rest of the miniature. I mean, look at that. It's just minuscule. He's really, it's almost like he's got, like, a tiny body inside of, like, a massive suit of armor. But, excuse me. It's weird. It just does not... It doesn't fit with the rest of the piece, and you can see here it looks decent here, and it may be simply that if we attach the maybe if I put that shoulder pauldron on, it kind of closes the area around his body up a little bit more, so it's not quite as open, so you don't notice it as much. And maybe if I were to put the giant eagle on the backpack here, let's do that real quick and see if I can do this with just two hands, but. I think that kind of helps fix it a little bit, just having that extra reference points of the larger pieces around the head. That makes the head sort of look a little bit larger, but I don't know, just it seems like it could be at least 1.5, maybe twice the size that it currently is, and it would have been a lot better looking. That's my only major complaint about this thing at all. And then, obviously, this, we have no instruction as to how specifically to attach the cape, although I think I've figured that out. I think it goes kind of, like I said, down here on this lower portion. But, again, there's no official connecting point, so it's very difficult to tell if that's the actual location that it's meant to go or not. But, overall, very, very, very cool miniature. I don't know by the time you guys see this episode of Hidden Treasures whether or not the Castellian Knight will still be available through Kabuki. But as I mentioned, it is probably available through eBay if it's something that you're interested in. By the way, I really am not a huge fan of that color scheme. It's a very, very, very contrasty scheme, but it does allow you to see a lot of the details and things like that. But I don't know. I see this guy in green armor. I think it would be a little bit better. I don't know. I suppose you could do him in yellow armor, but it just seems odd. I see him in like a darker green, or maybe a let's see here. Let's see what else could we do with him. Maybe a dark blue. But overall, dark blue. See, most of the armor here is yellow, and then like you've got blue elements to it, which I think is meant to be steel. But it was tinted with way too much blue, if that's the effect they were going for. It was like a chromatic steel. It got way too much blue in there. But overall, anyway, this is not a video about the paint job. Model itself, very, very, very cool miniature. Love the base on this thing. I mean, really, really awesome. The only thing I will say is I wish that with this pose right here, let me get the model back. I tell you what, let me get some blue tack here. I got a little ball of it that I keep around in case I need to kind of squish something together. That's a little too much, obviously. Can we do this? Can we get it done? Let's see. Let's put that there this time. Put it on the other side. And smush. All right, that's kind of... There we go. Okay. So if I put this guy on his base and sort of leave him there, the, let's see here, what side's going to be... Okay, so for the most part, make sure the head is positioned correctly. Yeah, okay, so... Alright, so that's not as bad as I thought it was. It's still a little annoying. Once you get this guy assembled, basically this is going to be the front of the model. And so you're kind of looking directly into this knee right here, which is a little weird because it kind of closes off the miniature a little bit. It would be better if this were the front of the model. You get to see a lot more of the miniature. But the only problem with having this be the front of the model is that this wing is broken and this wing looks a whole lot better. So it would be better if this wing were broken and this one were full. But again, this is not the front of the miniature, even though you get to see a lot more stuff. If you consider this the front of the miniature, it's fine. The only problem is now you have his fist in the way as well. And so it kind of, like I said, it kind of closes things off. So you've got either closed off from this side or closed off from this side. So it doesn't, the model doesn't really have a front, which is a little frustrating, but... Nothing that a nice little turntable spinny contraption can't fix. So overall, very, very, very cool piece. If you're interested in picking this thing up, you can try Kabuki's website. It's I believe it's kabukimodels.com. Let me make sure of that. And it's like literally impossible to read because their font is not great. But yes, it is kabukimodels.com. If it is no longer available from Kabuki, definitely check out the eBay scene and you may be able to find one of these Castellan Knights. Very, very, very cool kit. And definitely recommend you at least check it out. That's all I've got for you guys today for this episode of Hidden Treasures. I hope that you have enjoyed it. If you have any comments or questions, please feel free to leave those in the comment section down below. Also, be sure to leave a thumbs up on this video and subscribe to AG Productions so you don't miss out on any of these awesome videos. Thank you once again for watching. I really do appreciate it. God bless you all. Have a wonderful rest of the day, and I will see you all in the next video.